I think I'm playing chess, I see a king, I'm at his neck. I'm three steps ahead of every move, now that's a check. Yes, they wanna know my secret, it's because I never slept. All my nightmares are me at 40, life's a wreck. See my dad.
Oh, look at that, we're live.
Dude, we're back.
We're back.
We're back.
That was a long two weeks. That was a long 2 weeks.
It felt like forever, man.
Yeah. These mics are going to take a minute to get used to. Right? Yeah.
They work.
Yeah,
great.
The other one's like picked up from everywhere, but this is like so omnidirectional. Yeah, this is good. Well, guess what? We're back, everybody. Fernando Petty here, UVO Podcast.
New location.
New location. I'm here with Alan, my co-host. Oh, which camera do I look at?
I'm trying to figure that out too.
I know, right? I think, Alan, I think that one is yours right there, the little short one.
Perfect.
That one is, I believe, the whole room. There we go. I can see you guys. Nudia's right there. And this is mine, I think. All right. Okay. So first thing, this is a big ass project. And then we'll introduce our wonderful guest. But this is a huge project, right? Alan, how the hell did this get started?
How did what get started?
This project that we decided to take on.
What do you mean?
We left the other building.
Oh. Well, we outgrew the space that we were at.
Yeah.
I feel like our team began growing so much, month after month after month. And honestly, we ran out of space.
Yeah.
So we came to the point where, our team pretty much took up most of the building. And, it got to the point where I feel like I'm not trying to say we outstayed our welcome, but it just came to the point where we just wanted to do our own thing, get our own building. It's just a natural next step when it comes down to growth. On top of that, the studio was, a bit small, but it was what we had to work with, with what we had.
Yep.
But now that, we've expanded, we're growing, we wanted to show, the world and show everybody what we're all about, what we're working on. And, we want to get as many guests here as possible. Now we have room for, four people here. So it's going to be good, man. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. I'm really pumped. Yeah. I am used to this kind of stuff. You know that.
Yeah.
I'm used to this kind of stuff.
Yeah. It's all new to me.
But I was like, can we do it in 6 days, 7 days? Cause you got to order the equipment and you got to order everything. And you try to time everything correctly. And we had everything set up for yesterday and we had Nudia come by and we weren't ready. Right. And I'm happy we weren't ready because we were under a lot of pressure and you want to be in the right state of mind when we do something like this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So yeah, but I'm really excited that it's finally done. I finally got some sleep last night. I think I slept like 5 hours.
Good.
Just pretty good.
Perfect.
Right? Pretty good for me. Right. We still went to the gym at like 5 a.m. Daniel and I, he's been going. We'll throw a clip up with Daniel flexing. He's gaining some muscle there. But that's what this podcast is all about, right? It's about everybody getting better. It's about growth. It's about challenging yourself, overcoming those challenges. And I'm just really happy that we have a real space here that we can share, everyone's stories and ideas and, network, which is awesome. And that's what brings me to our guest, Nudia. So we're really excited to have you here. We talked about it for a while.
Yeah,
I think we wanted
to
get you in a few months ago at the other office.
Yeah.
But I'm happy we waited.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you are our first guest here at the new office.
There we go. So let me give you an introduction, quick, brief introduction. So I've known Nudia for about 2 years now. Nudia is the owner, the founder, the creator of Novation Title. She has an awesome story. She originally is from Mexico City.
Yeah.
Mexico City, DF. All right. I knew that. really happy to have you here. So thank you for coming. And we're really excited to hear your story. You shared with us a little bit about it yesterday. But really pumped to have you here because you're an awesome entrepreneur. We see you growing, right? I know you haven't. Novation Titles. How old is Novation Title?
We're going to be 6 in August.
6 years, and you guys have 3 locations.
Yes,
3 locations. That's pretty good. It's good growth,
dude. It's awesome, man. I love the fact, as I've known her for about 7 years now. I think when I barely got into real estate, my first month, I think it was. I think I told you this yesterday. First time I met Nudia. I just knew that she was a boss. I didn't even know her. I didn't know anything about her, but I'm like, this girl here, she's a boss. And it was cool watching her go from, watching her come up, from being at her old company and then branching off and building her own thing, about 6 years ago. So I got to watch, you know, that whole thing play out. And now you're watching us as well doing the, pretty much the similar thing, you know, where it just comes down to growth. So I've really enjoyed, you know, watching your story, watching you come up. And I love the fact that you come from nothing. Like, that's the one thing I absolutely love is when somebody comes from nothing, like myself, Fernando, et cetera. Like, those are the stories that I love to see and hear.
Thank you. I feel that's how we really connected.
Yeah.
You know, it was that immigrant story. All of us share that. And it's an honor to be here with you guys today. I'm a big fan. I'm a big supporter. And to be the first one in this new space is just amazing.
Yeah.
So I'm so proud of you. This is super fun, and it's like a legit podcast studio.
That's awesome. That's how you start, right? Can we get an applause over there? Hey, you guys are going to love this. We got Daniel in the room now. Daniel, we got to get a camera on you, right? So let's get another camera and get one on him, because Daniel really is the backbone of this whole thing. Mm-hmm. And if he wasn't here, we'd be probably doing it out of a van or something.
Yeah, and if you guys haven't checked out his podcast, that would definitely be one that I would strongly recommend taking a listening to. You know, young kid, you know, big dreams, big goals, and he's making it happen.
He's a cool dude for sure.
Yeah, it's really awesome to have him. But let's get into your story a little bit. So you came here from Mexico. Mm-hmm. How old were you when that happened?
So I arrived here when I was 11 years old, and my dad's side of the family is from Chihuahua, so that's where we came from, and all my mom's side of the family is from Spain, and so I love having that background. I love having my Hispanic background. I love having my European roots, and then also immersing myself into this American culture, you know, I like that diversity within me. It makes me more probably open to just relating to different people.
Yeah, so yeah.
I was 11. I came here. It was a complete culture shock. I mean, I was used to going to school in Mexico, and it was like, you brought your own lunch. You know, it was nothing like this. I arrived, and I remember my elementary school had a carpet, and the whole school was under one roof. I was like, what is happening? This is so fancy and elegant. And they fed you lunch in school. And it was quite the culture shock. I did not speak any English. I knew certain words like window, how are you, small sentences. But I've always been super loving of people. And I've always had a lot of friends or wanted to make a lot of friends. And so it was easy for me to just start trying to communicate with the children. And about a month into it, I was able to actually communicate. Not that I spoke fluently, but I was able to communicate. And it was an amazing process. I feel that I had an idea of what the United States of America was, and I knew that there was so much opportunity in this country. And me living in a different one really created the polarity for me to really know that this was the land of opportunity. This was the place where anything I wanted, I could create. And so, there was a culture shock. And then I found myself wanting to belong in the group of kids. And they were doing extracurricular activities like basketball or dance or gymnastics, things like that. And as I wanted to participate in some of those activities, my parents were always like, oh, Nuria, no hay dinero, which is like, there's no money for anything extra.
Yeah.
We're doing the best we can here. Yeah. We're an immigrant family. And although that was understood in a sense of, you know, as much as you can understand as a small child, there was also this, it was a defining moment for me that I heard it one too many times and I got pissed. There was a moment that I was just so upset because I wanted to do those things and I couldn't. And so I just remember declaring to the universe at one point and just said, I will never live my life like this. And it was in that moment where I knew that it was going to be up to me to make something of myself. And it was going to be up to me to create whatever wealth I wanted for me.
Yeah, that is a really good story.
Dude, that right there just reminds me so much of, you know, being a young kid and we're wearing the same shirt, same jeans to school every day, to the point where kids are telling you like, hey, wear something different. You stink or whatever it might be.
I got a funny story about that.
You know, we would get all of our clothes when, you know, from the DI.
And oh, dude, I love the DI. Shout out to the DI.
Straight up. That's where we shop too,
right?
Yeah.
Dude. We'd go get a whole bag. And I remember, like, what you mentioned, like, you declared. Like, I remember, I think it was, like, junior high. Like, I don't know. And everybody wanted to look good, you know. Seventh grade. Everybody, it's all about fashion. You know, I mean, you want to have the new shoes, you want to have the new shirt, the new pants, whatever it might be. And obviously, we couldn't really afford a whole lot. Like, my parents did what they could, you know. And but it's not like I can have anything I want to wear the rest of the week. But it made you want to just work that much more and that much harder to be able to get what you want. So in declaring that at a young age, you know, it shapes you.
Yeah, that's awesome. It's, and you know, it's, I swear that so many people who, decide to take their, I guess, destiny, future, right, into their own hands. Right. And I'm not referring to only money, you know what I mean? It can be like a happiness thing, but, I feel like a lot of them have a similar sort of story like that. And funny thing about the whole clothes thing, when I was younger, I wore these pants, right? That I always wore.
Jenkos?
Ooh.
I got those when I was like in the seventh grade. I think I wore them for like a week. They're too damn big. Those things are fucking crazy, right? No, but I wore these pants and I was like, man, I really want white jeans. I've always wanted white jeans, right? And so I remember getting like this bowl and putting it in my aunt's backyard and just hijacking her bleach. And I put my jeans in this bowl and we let them sit there for like a week. I don't know how they lived through that. Like, they should have just like got destroyed, right? But no, I ended up putting them in there because I wanted a pair of jeans and they came out looking beautiful. They were like perfectly white. And the only thing that didn't change was the little tiny threads on the side, like the seam. And then I was like, that's a pretty cool style. Like, and then later on, True Religion came out and they had that style where the thread is a different color. And I was like, oh man, I had that when I was like 11 years old, you know? But no, I totally get that and understand that. And I think that the lesson in that is it doesn't matter what age you are. You could have that epiphany at 11, 12, 13 years old, you know? And as long as you have the balls, right, and determination, you can easily make a change and make a switch and start making income at that age. I mean, what was your first job?
It's hard to remember.
Yeah, I've been, really
I've been
janitor
in the workforce
a sweeper
for so many years. Yeah, one of my very first ones. So I wanted to have enough money to be able to buy my school clothes, right? We're talking about the clothes and how important they are. So I got a job to clean a school during the summer. It was a middle school. And so while my friends were out playing and enjoying summer, I was every day cleaning the school, and I didn't mind. It was like a part of me, of course, felt, you know, some major FOMO, but at the same time, it was like, no, then I get to buy the clothes I want to. And there was a sense of freedom in that. So that was one of my first jobs. Yeah, I was literally a janitor just cleaning the school. I was probably 13. And before that, I did a lot of babysitting or cleaning houses also for people. I would just go and knock on neighbors' doors and be like, hey, can I clean your house?
Hustler.
And just to earn a buck, you know, I was never afraid of asking for business.
Yeah.
And yeah, just trying to make money.
Yeah.
So paper route. What else did I do? Then I did restaurants. That's all like you can really do in high school. I had work release. I had enough credits where I could get work release, and I'm like, yeah, get me out of here. I gotta go work. Yep. Yeah. I gotta go work so I can make money. And so, yeah, it was, I've always been a hard worker, and I paid my way through college. I did my 2-year degree. I didn't finish a full ride, which is fine with me because I truly believe in education academically or reading books, or there are so many other ways, right? Oh. It's for you to educate yourself. But yeah, I had about 3 jobs during college. So I was literally either working or in school and hardly had any time for anything else. But yes, it's been a wild ride.
Yeah.
But that was one of my first jobs. Yeah.
Yeah.
Janitor.
I did that. I did. I was a janitor at 16 at a resting home.
I was roofing at the age of 14,
man. So
all of
cool.
us, which started so early, you know, working. That's awesome. Why I feel like we are the way we are.
Yeah.
Just because we feel like we got into the workforce at an early age and we knew what we wanted. And yeah, here we are.
Go after it.
It makes you appreciate it that much more, I feel like.
Yeah. For all you guys out there, 12, 13, 14 year old.
Get to work.
My nephew, get to work. My niece, my nephew, my son, they all listen to this, you know? And I always think about what kind of message can I tell them or people who are watching, right? And I mean, if anything else, it's like, you don't have to wait until you graduate high school, you know, to start hustling. I mean, I was 12 years old. I was painting houses. I shared in one of the podcasts. It was like, I got so high because the guy didn't tell me that the paint, you weren't supposed to close the door in the closet. And so I'm in the closet painting at like 12 years old. And I walk out and I'm like floating on clouds. But I was in there for like a good hour, you know, yeah. trying to paint this closet. But no, I mean, I've had those experiences and they've always taught me, like, you know, even when I was, you know, 15, 16, 17, going through my little job phase, trying to start businesses, you know, 17, 18 years old, I remember my friends, they were graduating high school and I dropped out in 10th grade. And everybody was always like, I think from the outside looking at me, they looked at me like a failure. But I always knew inside, I was like, no, I know what I'm doing. You know, I'm going to figure this out. I don't have to go to college for this. And I remember watching my friends graduate and they went to school. And I'm not putting down education, right? I want my son to go to college. But I remember doing that, having that like experience, and you feel so alone, you know, when you're on that journey, trying to build your own business, trying to build your company, your own company, when everybody you know is doing the opposite, you know? And so you kind of just become a lone wolf, mm-hmm. you know, yeah. And you know what that's like.
Yeah.
You know, we would always have these conversations at my school. We'd be alone in the school. I'd be cutting his hair back when I had my hair school. And we'd always be saying that, like, dude, like, we don't really have a lot of friends.
Like, yeah.
You know what I mean? We just kind of do our own thing. And everything that we do is about the business that we're trying to work on and build and grow.
So, yeah, it's just so tough to relate with other people, you know. And it's not like you're right or they're wrong, except, you know, vice versa. But it's just a little different. That's why I feel like you and I, we got along so well. Like, we were on our own journeys at that time. But straight, like, I was a lone wolf and you were a lone wolf. Oh.
Now we got a pack. UVO pack. Right? Hey, pull the mic down and a little closer to you, bro. That way you can get it a little.
That good?
Pull the mic closer to your face. Yeah, these are new, so we got to adjust them a little bit. Let's see, Yeah, these ones are a little newer. The other ones, like, picked up everything, so hopefully it sounds good in post. Yeah, we'll see. I can't get this one right.
We'll see. If not, Nudia, we'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah, we'll see you tomorrow, Nudia. No, but let's get back to you real fast, right? Because I feel like it's been 2 weeks, and we're a little rusty. We need to get back into the zone and the energy, but I want to get back to you and talk about you, because Novation Title is a good company. It's a big company. You guys are doing really well. Like, I've been there. I think I shared with other title companies as well, you know, from the agent side, the experience, because that's what you hear with title companies, right? They're always like, we want to give the best experience. And they all say that. But it's so damn boring.
They don't deliver.
It's always boring, right? You go in there, you sit at the table. Sometimes they don't even hand you the closing docs. And you just sit there and you're waiting for them to hurry up. And sometimes I'll have my wife call, text her, and I do this to Daniel too. I'll be like, hey, call me real fast so I can get the hell out of here. And then I'll leave, right? I'll leave. And then I wait until they're done and then I go back in. It's like, it's just so boring in there. And you know what I mean? And so an agent.
That happened like 2 weeks ago, actually. We were in a meeting, you and I, with a few people.
I do this all the time.
I don't know where he gets a call. He's like, hey, steps out. He never came back in. So I'm in the meeting alone. Like, is this dude coming back or what?
My time is so valuable.
He left me.
My time is so valuable. And if I'm in a meeting where there's no value, I'm getting the hell out. That's why I don't go to lunch with people. That's why I don't go to coffee with people. It just, you know, it's the same thing as Ellen. Like, there's no point, right?
Yeah.
A lot of the times it's just stroking their ego. So I hate doing that. I just want to get the hell out. But with the title stuff, you have to be in there. You're trying to support your client, right? Which is awesome. But we always looked at, like, how can we have a really good experience? You know? And I shared my ideas with you, and you were totally open to them, which I love. And some other title companies were too, you know. But what I did love about when I toured your I believe it was your first one. Was it your first office over there?
Redville?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Dude, that thing is so nice.
Dude, she had a meditation room.
That's what I'm saying. That's a stressful. You're signing. Yeah. You're signing the largest financial commitment of your life there in that office. And instead of it being fun and exciting and all these things these title companies promise, it should be relaxing. You should be in the right state of mind, right?
Yeah.
You should have support there. The environment should be supportive, right?
Yes.
Can't be like a cold room that's like a prison cell, or, you know what I mean? I've seen some title companies like that, but I'm just saying, you know, this is a place that's extremely important, right?
Yes.
And so I'm happy that you guys thought about that. And I saw that meditation. It's like a real meditation. It's like incense. You can pick your own like scents, right?
Didn't yeah, you have the like scents. You we have all the different stones. We yeah. just tell you what type of energy each stone, you know, has, so you yeah. can choose whatever you want to meditate to. And yeah, that's the whole reason why I decided to launch my own title company, because I'd worked for two, and I did that type of work for a 9-year period before I went on my own. But I kept noticing that people would come in to buy a home or sell their house, and they would, it'd be their first time maybe cashing out on a bunch of equity. And it was such an important moment of their lives, you yeah. know, and you know, our product isn't sexy. Title insurance isn't sexy.
Are you kidding me?
But, but where I was really disconnected to my own industry was I just kept seeing all these people coming in feeling like another number. And I just thought, how can I help redefine this whole experience? Because this isn't right. And this isn't, this can't be it, that you come in and you feel like another number, sign, buy. And I felt like all the title companies looked the same. It was like grandma and grandpa's house, and everyone dealt with the people the same way. And I'm like, no, this can't be it. So I started envisioning and imagining what it would look like for people to actually be able to celebrate that big moment and how we could really be a part of that.
Yeah.
And so that's where all of the ideas started flowing. And I would just write them down in my journal. I would talk to my old boss about them and say, hey, have you thought of this? Have you thought of that? And we all can relate. We're all entrepreneurs, where you have all these brilliant ideas and maybe some that won't land for the person you're presenting them to, but your mind just doesn't stop, right? You're yeah. this creator. And so I would keep coming up with all these ideas, throwing them at my boss. Some, you know, were implemented. Most of them were not, but I just felt like I have to disrupt my industry this way. It's so old. Most of my title company owners are, you know, middle-aged men, and I love men. I love the masculine energy, but I just felt like I was, one, younger. I was 31 when I launched it, and two, I was coming from more of that nurturing feminine energy, which really wants to take care of people, really wants to create a difference. And so that purpose really drove me.
Wow. Hey, I like to take care of people. Yeah. No, Daniel, you're doing that too much.
yes, you do. And I'm not saying people don't, but there's like a nurturing side.
Yeah, there is.
And mm-hmm. that's what I wanted to really come across. And so, yeah, it's just been innovating consistently to be that forward-thinking company, not only just locally, nationwide. You know, I get an opportunity to public speak quite often and be a part of podcasts or different type of events or conventions, and we do stand out. And I love being able to create a ripple within a very old industry.
Yeah. Let's talk about something that I saw you posted, which is pretty cool, because Ellen and I thought about doing this. You actually trademarked your logo, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So what was that process like?
It was actually a lot easier than I thought it would be. So I just reached out to my attorney and said, hey, my friend, who was also a title company owner in DC, just got someone else that launched their own company using pretty much her name and just added a couple of words. And she was really upset about it, because it's her brand, right? Yeah. It's your baby. It's like UVO podcast and UVO team, all of it. And so she said to me, hey, if you have not trademarked your logo and your brand, I highly suggest you do. This is what happened to me. I honestly didn't think about it too much, but it is important to me. Everything, even from my name to my logo, there's a whole story behind it. Yep. And so it means something to me. So I just reached out to my attorney. He started all the paperwork, but it did take about 8 to 9 months to go through with it. By the way, if you guys are going through a trademark process, you'll get random mail from people trying to get you to pay them random fees. Make sure you don't get into that.
Get scammed.
Into the scam. Make sure you still connect to your attorney. But yeah, it felt very complete, you know, once it came out, and it was like, okay.
It feels official.
This is protected. Us. Yeah. Protected. It's protected. Absolutely.
Yeah. We talked about that months ago, and I'm like, we got to get our stuff all trademarked.
Yeah.
You never know at the end of the day. And it is your baby, you know, what you're building. Yeah. So I get it.
Especially when you care so much about your brand, mm-hmm. which I do, and you guys do too. So.
Yep. Yeah. Super important. Let's talk about something else here. Nudie, you dating? What's going on there? She told me yesterday. I don't want to talk about my personal life. I said, oh, okay. All right, yeah.
There we go. Let's do it.
You know what? This morning I thought what's going to happen is exactly what I told him that I'm private about. That's what's going to come
up.
Uh-huh.
We don't have to go there yet. But no, I want to go back to your journey because you left a lot of stuff out. And I know that it wasn't easy for you to start your business. You know, we talked about it yesterday that there's some months, and Alan and I have had this, and I'm sure other entrepreneurs out there who have this, even right now, they're probably experiencing this, where, you know, you feel like, how the fuck am I making it?
Yeah.
Right? Like, how am I making it right now? And you brought up the whole intention, right? Like when you have a good intention and, you know, you're staying the course, you know, somehow things seem to
work out.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's so Tony Robbins, I'm a big fan. He's been my biggest teacher the past 10 years. I just joined his Platinum Partnership, which is the highest level membership you can pretty much get with him. But he says that business is a spiritual game. And I love that. Because
I've never heard that. And I love that.
I believe that so much. And so what we were talking about yesterday is, as an entrepreneur, as a business owner, when you're out there hustling and pushing and creating and attracting, there's so much that gets thrown at you on a daily basis. And I feel like people think that they shouldn't have problems, and that's our first problem. because every day there's challenges, and you guys know you're leaders in your own company. And so what I do all day is pretty much create answers or find a way, right? And sometimes there's so much being thrown at you and you're at the top. So you're like, where do I go for, just to like bounce ideas off people and thank God you have, you know, you create your circle and you have mentors and things like that. But you do sometimes feel alone. It's all up to you. And so there are moments in the journey where you feel like, how in the hell am I going to handle this right now? Yeah. Like, how, I don't even know where to start. Where do I go? How do I find a solution to this? To a point that it's like, it's so overwhelming. And so in those moments where you feel like, why in the hell am I doing all of this for? What always has brought me back to staying focused and in the game has been my purpose.
Yep.
And if you don't have that, if you're not clear on your mission, then when you have those breaking point moments of how in the hell am I going on, your purpose is the only thing that will keep you moving forward.
Yep.
And when I've had those moments, and every time that you have a bigger problem and then you figure it out, because you always do. We have everything within us to be able to pull through. Even when in that instance, you might not think you can. But once you actually push through and get it and figure it out, man, you're like, holy shit. Your threshold just keeps expanding, right? Yep. And I truly believe that the higher the problem you're able to solve for your community, for your clients, for the people around you, the higher money you'll attract, the more money you'll be able to attract. Figure out bigger problem, you're going to make more money.
Yeah.
And so there's that first part of it. And then the other part of it is, and that's really where we connected, and the whole thing about business being a spiritual game is, wow, you sometimes are like, I don't even know how this is going to happen, but you take major action, you find a solution, and I call them miracles. I don't know what else to call them in business sometimes, because I'm like, I don't even know how this all worked out. And someone really has my back. Mm-hmm. And I figured out that if you're giving to life, life will give it back to you. So life will support more of what supports life.
I love that. Can we get some fire on there? Is there fire on there? You just dropped a bomb. No, straight up. That's awesome because he told me that yesterday and I haven't heard that one before either. But it, I mean, it makes total sense. You know, when we talked about Alan, I would always say like, dude, like it's crazy that number one, we've only been doing this for 13, 14, 15 months mm-hmm. maybe. We grew 900% in the last year, which is an amazing amount of growth. And we were looking at all of our expenses when we first started. And Alan and I were cash flowing this thing at the beginning. And it was not easy, you know, because we completely took a backseat to the whole real estate agent side of it. And we focused completely on our business and our brand. 100%. 100%. Left hundreds of thousands of dollars on the table, right? And I was like, how the hell are we going to do this? But we looked at our expenses month over month and they kept climbing and climbing, but we were always able to hit it. You know, and I mean, look at the growth we're having right now. This shit is not free.
Yeah.
This shit is fucking expensive, right? But we're still able to invest in our business because that's what we choose to do. And, you know, we're not having like, I mean, granted, Alan has an amazing lifestyle, but this is the work that he's put in 6-7 years. You know, I just started this and, you know, Alan, I talk about it all the time, like, dude, we're still growing, but we're still able to support ourselves from the company mm-hmm. and give so much back to the agents. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And again, I'm always like, how the hell are we making this happen? But I feel like because we have so much good intentions and we know what our why is and we know what our purpose is, it always works out.
Yeah, that's one thing I noticed too, is everything just works out. I mentioned this thing to you guys yesterday where it's probably maybe half a year ago, give or take, where, you know, when you're building a company, it's not easy. You know, you're not paying yourself. Everything you're paying is going out and more. Especially when you're not out there with your clients, et cetera, you're strictly focusing on the business. There's multiple nights where I would literally just stare outside of my condo, outside and just wonder, why am I doing this? Mm. What are you trying to prove? What is the point? What are you trying? You know what I mean? People ask you, why are you working so hard? Why this? And there's days where you question it and go, why am I trying to inspire so many people? Why am I trying to motivate as many people? You know, they're not appreciating it or this or that. Mm-hmm. And you have those days where you just kind of take a step back. Like I know where it hit me was, I think, when we barely began being cash flow positive.
Yeah.
I think I remember that. Me and you were looking at the board, and we were about to have our biggest month. But prior to then, holy shit, it was stressful.
Yeah, the wintertime was stressful.
where I'm like, man, is this ever going to, like, work month after month after month after month? But that's the name of the game, you know. It's patience, persistence, and perseverance.
Uh-huh.
You gotta just stay the course. And that's the one thing I noticed too. And early on in my career too is, you know, my first year and a half, I did five deals only, made probably like, I don't know, 20, 30 grand, if that, which is not a whole lot of money. You know, your average person, anybody would kind of just go, hey, this real estate thing is not really working. It's not really working for me, but I didn't give up. Almost did though, where I'm like, am I really made for this or not?
Yeah.
But you stick through it. And just over that little hump is when things began taking off.
Yeah.
You know, went from doing, five deals in a year to the following year, 36. That's a night and day jump.
Huge.
But because you didn't give up, it's kind of like, I forgot who it was, but then when they were searching for gold and they quit digging like, I don't know, a foot.
Yeah, there's actually a story about that. I heard that story.
Is it Dale Carnegie? Not Dale. I forgot who it was, but it's like 1 foot from gold or something like that. And they just gave up when if they would have put just a little bit more work in, they would have got that payoff.
Yeah. No, I mean, we all share the same thing where we know this, truly know this, that entrepreneurship is a game of grit. You know, you have to have grit to go through all the tough months, to go through the growth, to go through all the growing pains that we have, that everybody has when they're building a company. It's not handed to you overnight, and people see that, and I think it confuses them. You know, they're like, oh, wow, Alan's got a Lamborghini. Like, he must be handed money, or he must be, you know, his parents must have helped him out or something.
Well, what they don't realize is I was living in my parents' basement just saving up cash, you know, and just working my ass off 24/7.
Yeah.
You know, it's eventually.
You guys know David Goggins. Have you read his book?
Can't Hurt Me?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good one.
I love the quote he has in there because he says, people want the glory without the pain.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what people see. Yeah. And any of us that are succeeding or, you know, play these roles and people are like, oh, they have it easy. They see our glory. They see that we travel. They see that we buy nice things and so on. But it's like, you have no clue.
Yep.
That you know, when you were out playing all summer, I was grinding. Yep. So all of those years, to me, it's a compound effect of all of our lives.
Yep.
It's your grind since you were little. It's your hustle since you were little. Finally end up paying off at one point, but everyone's like, oh, that just looks so easy. It's like, that's the furthest thing from it. Yeah. It's not easy at all. You just see the glory and you don't want to experience the pain. It is painful.
It's fucking painful. Yeah. It is painful. And Al and I talk about all the time where we're sometimes staring at each other, either during a meeting or over here at the office, and him and I were like telepathic at this point. You know, we can like read each other's minds. I swear.
You're like, crazy, what did he just say?
Yeah, no, yep. But we look at each other like, oh, this is like stressful. And I could see it the other day with Alan. We were talking and he's like you almost get like this brain fog, you know, when you're just so stressed out because you have so much that's piling up and surmounting. And when we were sitting there, we were talking about it. I had this conversation with myself in the past. So it was pretty cool that I was able to share it with Alan. You know, I was like, dude, this amount of stress is good for you, right? You can look at it two ways. You have it regardless, okay? If we continue down this path and grow this company, the stress is going to be there regardless how we look at it, right? Yeah. And if we choose to embrace it in a positive way, I've always looked at heavy, heavy amounts of stress, business stress. I'm not talking about family or loss. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about business stress. It's like, I would say when you take it and you take it on and you really feel it and you understand that it's for your growth and it's for your purpose and it's for your business, it's almost like a little stepping stone to get to the next level of stress. You know, you can't take somebody who's frying burgers behind the McDonald's line at 18 years old and put them in the CEO position immediately. It doesn't happen. Right. You have to go through those levels of stress. And they have to get their mind used to it. You know, David Goggins talks about it. It's that callousing your mind. You know, you have to callous your mind and get it used to that stress, you know, so that when it hits you, it's not going to throw you off because it's going to come over and over with every level that you achieve in your business. It's going to get more and more and more. And, you know, I shared that with Alan and I think he understood it. I'm pretty sure
I did.
But it's like, you know, it makes so much sense when you experience it, because if you let it kill you, you know, and destroy you the first two or three hurdles in your business, you're never going to be successful.
You're going to be out. You're going to quit.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You're going to quit.
It's not for the sissies. That's for sure. Yeah. And I've loved the person it's made of me because of all the challenges and all the struggles I've experienced. And it just has created a stronger me. And I love it. You know, I wouldn't trade it for the world. Painful and as all the challenges, there's obviously success and amazing transformations and people, and that's what I live for. I love being able to help people grow and help them reach their dreams and transform them from the inside out in all areas of life, not just business. But yes, the strength that I've been able to get to, that sometimes in those moments I haven't known if I'm strong enough, sometimes, to be honest. Yeah. And then you just find energy, I don't know from where, and you just go and kill it and pull through. Keep going. So,
yeah. So your company's business model, you guys, you're not doing franchises right now, right?
No. Yeah. It's just, I'm the sole owner and I'm obviously growth is one of my biggest values in life, but I definitely want to keep expanding Utah. At one point I thought I was wanting to take it nationwide, and not that I'm super opposed to the dream, but I got a little taste of it going to California and wanting to start it there, and it's a completely different market and ball game. But then I realized that the dream I was chasing wasn't really truly what I wanted. I don't know if that's ever happened to you guys, where you have this idea, like you go, and then you're like, but why am I really doing all this for? Uh-huh. Yeah. So I had that moment, and I realized I could still, the real rooted reason I wanted to expand was to really be able to help as many people as possible. But I can do that in so many other ways. Yeah, and it doesn't have to be. Yes. And so sometimes asking really good questions to yourself, you really will find the truth within you. And I always encourage that. Stay true to who you are and don't live based on other people's expectations of who you should become.
Yep. And that made me kind of realize these words stuck with me, gosh, I don't even know, 5-6 years ago, I think it was maybe. And it's like life is happening for you, not to you.
Yep.
Yes.
And that really stuck with me, because going back to what you just mentioned a minute or two ago, where you get caught up in that stress and everything, and you have to embrace it. You have to just take it in and go, hey, this is supposed to happen. Everything's supposed to happen exactly. Because, yeah, you have days where you're like, how the hell am I going to make it? How the hell am I going to make that payment? How am I going to? But life always works itself out. But you have to believe that it will. That's the number one thing. You have to believe in it. And, you know, it's like the manifestation. You manifest anything you want. Like, I think I mentioned this to Fernando maybe a couple of months ago about my car. I had a picture of that exact car on my phone a year prior. The exact car, the exact color, the exact interior, even the exact license plate.
Wow.
Which was insane because I got the car in Connecticut. And I remember sending that picture to the owner. And I'm like, hey, check this out. Look what I just found on my phone. And it's like manifestation to a whole other level. Like that was a year before I even got the car. He's like, where did you find that car picture? I'm like, I don't know. I found it on Google somewhere. It was a pretty cool car. So I saved the picture on my phone.
The law of attraction and its magic. Uh-huh. I am obsessed with that whole thing. Yeah. It really works.
Yeah.
But it all starts with your mind. And so whatever you believe you can achieve, it will happen, right? And whatever you are focused on and all the thoughts, and that is what you're creating in life. And language. Like if you notice everything that we talk about, all the things you're talking about consistently, even for example, this effing pandemic that everyone was all,
you can swear on here, by the way. All,
thank you. Okay. Fuck yeah.
There we go.
So the whole pandemic, the whole world's talking about it. That's the stress, the energy that is being put back into that same cycle. Now that everyone's feeling much safer, you know, a lot of vaccinations. And so therefore the mindset shifts. There's not as much language in what's happening that everything keeps going down. Numbers keep going down. And that's just an example of the power of the mind.
Less people are talking about it. Yeah, less people are talking about it.
Because the language is not there anymore. Yeah. And then literally, like, language is a part of the manifestation process.
Yeah. So let's go back to your business for a second. So,
Before anything, I want to mention, that's a perfect example of why you want to surround yourself with only positive people.
Yeah.
And you don't want to be watching negativity. Too many people get caught up in the news and this many people are dying or this many people are dying.
I don't watch the news. I haven't for like 10 years.
That's what I mean. Me too. Yeah. I've had a TV in like 7 years. You know, yeah. I have one, but I don't ever even watch it. But it's one of those things that people just get so caught up in that. And automatically, you know, they feed that information to their friends, their family, et cetera. It's just this cycle, I feel like. And that's why I made a rule, like, you know, a few years ago where I'm like, I don't want to be around any negative people. I want to cut off all the negative people, whether it's friends or family, et cetera. I don't need any of that in life. I just want to be happy, positive people. That's it.
Yeah. 100%.
Yeah. Too many people are easily influenced by their surrounding and they become a product of their environment. Right. It happens way too often and it's so subconscious. You know what I mean? And we see that all the time. And, you know, when the pandemic did strike, when it was like at its, I guess everyone was the most fearful, you know, when everyone was wearing like hazmat suits going to the grocery store. That was like March, April, May.
I think clearing out the grocery aisles and everything.
Yeah. Right. When that was going on, I almost felt like I felt so much compassion for those people because I thought to myself, how fucking stressed out they must be in order to go and take all the toilet paper from and my kids and the wipes.
The real fear that you see on the people. You're like, oh my God.
Yeah. And like, you can get pissed. Like, come on. I've seen people argue in the grocery store for baby wipes and I would have happily jumped in there and took some, you know, cause I needed them. But I was thinking about it when I was witnessing this and I thought to myself, like, I'm so happy that I could see through this bullshit and this bullshit human behavior.
Yes.
And I didn't participate in that nonsense and I refused to participate in those conversations, right? And it did affect people that I know and it did affect family of friends that I have who they actually passed away, you know what I mean? And whatever it was from, COVID, whatever, bad health decisions, you know what I mean? Stuff like that. But I chose to surround myself with the people that I worked with in our environment and we didn't let it affect us.
Yeah.
And we grew the most during the pandemic. Yeah. And I heard this today, and I don't want to get political, but I heard this with Biden, and he was talking about, I think it was a speech he did yesterday, the day before, increasing the taxes for everyone up to, I believe, 400,000 or maybe 250,000. And I was listening to what he was saying, and it sounded almost like he was putting the people down who made money during the pandemic, the people who grinded, the people who went out and built companies, the people who fucking hustled, the people who didn't sit there and wait for handouts during the pandemic. And when he was talking about how much growth, how much people had made and how their income tripled, doubled, quadrupled, whatever, during the pandemic, I thought to myself, wow, good for them.
Yeah.
Like
they put the work in.
Yeah.
Now you want to punish them
for that? Yeah. Like, how the hell does that make any sense? I don't understand that. And so, and I know that some people, okay, maybe there's some people pulling some shit. Like, you know, the whole, I saw people on KSL buying all the toilet paper and like, selling, you know, it. Price, oh, yeah, gouging, yeah, this shit. Yeah. Like, hey, they hustle. They're, yeah, doing their thing. I don't condone that behavior, yeah, but
like morally.
Yeah. I mean,
but kinda, like they were smart. Yeah.
They hustled. There's, right. You know, but, and the people making masks before the masks were like, you know, manufactured professionally and all over the place. But, you know,
there's
just
opportunity in
there
any,
is. And why anything punish, mm-hmm, those people who are thinking outside the box? It makes no fucking sense to me. And it drives me nuts. It really does.
We had our biggest year ever as well last year, which was not projected. Obviously, everyone was uncertain of what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. We were all in the same place, but you always have to stay ahead of the game for whenever that winter comes in, that you have a few options and take major action. I will say that under different circumstances, though, luckily in our industry, we were some of the industry that we had no limitations. I do have compassion for some other businesses, like, yes, restaurants and places like that they literally just couldn't.
Yeah, they had no option.
Yeah. So when, yeah, you shut all of that down, you know, it is hard to watch, because, you know, we know what it takes to build something. And so those type of situations are heartbreaking. But having said that, there were also restaurants that pivoted and they found new ways. You know, I knew my friend in Florida. She said one of the restaurants created these cooking lessons that people could watch through Zoom, and then they would go and actually deliver the actual food. So there's so much creativity. Like, no matter what happens, you can find,
yes,
a solution or a new idea, yep, to get out. There's always opportunity.
Yeah. You have to be innovative.
Yeah.
You have to be innovative. And no, I understand that. You know, I come from the hair industry, and the hair industry got hit really hard. Yeah. Salons closed, barbershops closed, schools closed. And I felt sorry for those people, you know.
Yeah.
Luckily, I know a lot of them are hustlers, and they'll just go home and cut hair.
Yeah, there's always a way.
There's always,
yeah,
a way.
Yes.
Yeah, there's always a way. And if there's not a way, then you pivot.
Yeah.
You know, then you pivot. You don't sit there and wait for permission to get off your ass and start making,
absolutely,
money again.
Absolutely.
You don't wait for permission. You get up and you fucking go and make money.
Exactly.
Right? And you go and hustle. You know, but you're right. This industry that we're in, the real estate industry, we're lucky enough to where, you know, we're able to make it through. And a lot of us made, you know, our biggest years last year, and we grew a business last year, and
so
you had your biggest year last year, you know.
But all of what people don't realize is all of us doubled down, though. Like, we put it all on the line. It could have gone the other way. Everything could have gone the other way. You know, everybody we brought on board, we were investing a shit ton of money. That could have easily gone the other way, but you believe that it will work out, and it did.
Yeah.
And that's
is what belief is full certainty. You know, I see those words as very almost the same, because you cannot believe in something if you have any lack of certainty that it's going to work out. So, yes, like, you guys had a vision. You fully believed in it with full certainty. Like, this is the way, and it's happening.
Mm-hmm.
It's done.
Yep.
And so that's what takes you there. But if you're like, I don't know, maybe, I'm not sure. Same with self-belief.
Yeah.
If there's any uncertainty in there of, I'm just not sure, I don't know, maybe one day. It's like, no, you fully believe it, and then it happens. Yep. Like, obviously, all these other steps, but you have to have full certainty in that dream and that vision.
Yeah.
It's going to happen.
It's so important, especially when you're growing business.
Oh, yeah, you have to have that. You have to have that vision. That's why, you know, yeah, both of us being, you know, all three of us being a bit visionaries,
yeah,
you got to see that vision. You got to be able to see that that house so built already before it's even, you know, being built.
The car you saw. Like, wow. It's seriously amazing.
Yeah. And even, like, my license plate as well. Like, on the back it says, yeah. Told you. When I was 18 years old, I told myself, because I remembered, I'm like, wait a minute. Because I was wondering, what should I get on my plate? You know, my other one has UVO on it. I'm like, I want to do something different. And I remember when I was, like, 18, and I was selling juice for an MLM company, by the way. It was pretty good juice, though. It was, like, $40 a bottle.
Scam.
But I told myself, I'm like, man, when I get to the point where I can own my dream car and everything, I'm going to get a license plate that just says, told you. By that, I mean, like, hey, I told you that I would make it. I told you I wouldn't give up. You know, I told you I would succeed. And that was the one thing, like, even when I left my old company as well, being told, you were there with me, being told by people there, like,
you'll be back.
You'll be back. Yeah. You'll be back. You're going to fail.
I've funny. Heard that before.
And I'm like, I will not come back. I will be dead before I come back anywhere because I am not going to give up. Yep. And you never want to go backwards at the end of the day. Like, so that stuck with me.
That's so true. Can we maybe talk about that? Because I think that's so important when you have a dream, a vision, and you start telling people about it. And how many crabs?
Yeah, how many non-believers
are
yeah.
like no because of all of these reasons yeah, and all excuses? Of their reasons. Uh-huh. Exactly. And so they're like, I mean, I heard all of that. You're crazy. This is the worst time to open up a title company. You're like everything, like you shouldn't do it. So many people were trying. Most people were trying to talk me out of it.
Yep. Especially and friends and family, I'm guessing.
Family was really supportive.
Good.
But like everyone else was like, you're crazy. Yeah. What are you doing? You know? And this is the thing though. Once you know, once you have that full certainty and belief in your vision and what you want to create in this world, nothing is getting in your fucking way.
Yep. Nothing.
Like once you have that clarity and it's like, it's happening. I don't care who you are to come and try to tell me what I can or cannot do. Like your opinion means nothing to me. You're so laser focused that you're like, I don't care. No, thank you. But the truth is that people really do try to like, no, because of all these reasons. And exactly. You nailed it, Fernando. It's like, no, all they're telling me are their own limitations of why they can't step up to become the person they really should be in this life and, you know, be able to serve at like the highest levels.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that is so fucking true. And too many people listen to them. Mm-hmm. They listen to them. And I, you know, okay. So I had this conversation. I was liquidating assets from a school that we had acquired. And I was holding like this yard sale type thing in the back of our school from another school. And it was everything that they've had in there. And it was like a big, like 40-foot semi, some massive semi. And we were unloading everything. And I had a lot of people like come by. And I was so tired. I didn't want to load it back in the trailer. So I hired this homeless guy to sleep there at night to watch all my inventory in the back. Right? This guy was amazing. He stayed up all night. I don't know how he stayed up all night. How did he stay up all night? Right? Anyways, the dude stayed up all night and never slept. Okay. All this energy in the world. Anyway, so I meet the guy, talk to him. He hangs out. The next morning, there's some people there who are looking at some of the items. And I noticed that I think he knew some of them, you know. But anyways, he ended up leaving. And I was talking to these people. And these guys were on bikes. And this guy and a girl, they're on bikes. And they're asking me, hey, how much can I buy one of the, I think it was like an electrolysis machine that was like really old and outdated. I would have gave it to him for free, you know. Anyways, the dudes were like, where'd this come from? I was like, oh, it came from another school, you know, we had acquired. And the girl was like, oh, what do you do for work? And I said, oh, you know, I own the school. And she's like, oh, you own your own business? And I was like, yeah. And her demeanor shifted. And she was like upset, like offended that I owned a business. And it was really strange. It's coming from this girl who was, I don't want to be rude or anything, but she was a homeless drug addict, right? And she's on her bicycle and she's like, oh, I would never own my own business. And I was like, oh, why is that? You know, can I ask you honestly, like, who told you that? And she's like, oh, my mom always told me that you should never own your own company. Right. And she said, my mom told me that you should never own your own company. And I looked at her like, what? Your mom told you that? And she's like, yeah. And I said, why did she tell you that? And she said, oh, man, because you guys have to pay taxes and you guys have to pay employees. And she was naming all these fears, right, that her mom put in her head. And she was like, and the biggest thing is when the economy crashes. And I was like, and like all these things, like it's something that a real entrepreneur doesn't even care about or think about. But she's like, when the economy crashes, like, you know, it's just, I would never do that. It's terrible. And she said it, and it was like, there was so much emotion and like passion behind the reasons why she wouldn't ever be like successful or own her own company. And I'm like, damn, like that is fucked up. That came from your mom. Your mom told you that? Like, oh my gosh, like I'm so blessed that, you know, my mom, she was always supportive in whatever the hell I wanted to do. You know what I mean? And like when you said, yeah, oh, friends and family, like I thought about the differences between the Hispanic families and the Bosnian families. There's a lot of similarities there. I think it's not a culture thing. I think it's an individual thing. But, you know, when I look at people who came from third world countries, especially war-torn countries, you know, that went through so much, they come here and they just want a nice, smooth, they don't want to go through anything like that again. You know, and I think about Alan, and I love Alan's parents. They're amazing people. His dad actually came and painted the podcast studio. And he did it really good and really fast. Like, like they're really fucking good people. I'm telling you right now, shout out to Alan's parents. But there's a difference in mentality and how you view the world, where you have people like us who are extremely, extremely okay with taking risks and huge fucking risks, right? Like we're okay with that. And it doesn't scare us. And it scares a lot of people. And it shouldn't. It shouldn't.
Yeah. You know what I mean? That's when you grow the most. You have to be able to risk.
Yeah, at all. You know, Gary Vee said something. You listen to Gary Vee?
Yeah, I love him,
right? He said something. He said,
I met him once.
He was talking to somebody who was asking, and they were like, I'm older in my 40s, and I'm looking to, you know, invest in this business or start my own company. And he's like, well, what's stopping you? And he's like, my age. And he was like, what are you talking about, your age? Like, are you crazy? You are so young still, like in your 40s. He's like, I'm not telling you to do this at like 85 years old. He's like, but you are young enough to recover. Mm-hmm. And I don't think people think about that. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, it's not hard to recover from a failure. You just pick yourself back up and you start again. And there's always easy access to capital.
You can do it again.
Yeah. Like, if you fail, okay, find another crew and do it again. Like, come on, do your own thing. But I think people let that stop them when they think, fuck, I'm in my 30s, clock is ticking, I think it's too late, I'm just going to shoot for my 64-5 retirement. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're still young, man. Like, I'm 30 right now, for example. Yeah. And I mean, I know when I was younger, I used to view 30 as like such a, you know, oh man, you're old, you're 30, you're 40, et cetera. You know, when you're like 15, 18, whatever, you're like, man, 30. But now that you're 30, you're like, dude, I'm young, I feel good. I feel like I have more energy now than before. Because I feel like you've gone through a lot, you know, because I feel like in your early 20s, you're trying to figure life out. You know, I feel like you really are. You have other people's opinions. You have, should I go to school? Should I not go to school? What should I do for work? You have so much on your plate that I feel like just now that I'm 30 and we're building a company, like, it's perfect. Even if I was 40 right now trying to, and wanting to build a company, it wouldn't change anything. We're going to do it, like, and we're going to succeed no matter what. Is, you know, my mindset is I'm not going to fail.
Like, if not. Anything, you're wiser. Like, exactly. You learned from those mistakes and how you fell on your ass. And but I think it's so good you brought that up, Fernando. The fact that just the difference in mentality and the way people think and the systems that your environment implements into you. Like this perfect example you shared of the story of this lady, her, the system that continues in cycles and generations, and she'll probably continue
the cycle. Yep.
But I'm telling anyone who's watching this or listening that you have full capability of destroying a cycle of a system.
Yep.
At any moment you can choose to say, this is bullshit. This is not really what I believe. And I'm going to destroy this from the future of my generations.
Yep.
It stops here.
Yep. My wife and I talked about that. We're like, hey, should we change our last name and just start with a new...
Start fresh.
New family tree. You know, and we're just joking around. That is an option. You could go change it and start from scratch. You know what I mean?
At any moment.
But you know what? I think a lot of people at least the ones who can start to see that, like, hey, I realize there's a problem here with the way I was raised or with the way that I've been taught or with my views and beliefs, and maybe they're a little outdated or maybe they just don't apply or work with today, right? Which is, I mean, it's good that you realize that, but I feel like people need support in implementing new ideas and change. And I know that coaching is a big deal for you, and that's something that I found that really helped me get out of a lot of old patterns, belief patterns and behaviors and neural pathways. And I use coaching to help get me there, you know? And I mean, I'm telling you, this lady that I use right now, she saved my fucking life. You know, her name is Catherine Dixon, like, saved my life, you know, like, straight up. And I think about that and I'm like, damn, what would I have done without her? And how many people are out there struggling that don't know about this?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I think it's important. I know it's important to have a coach.
No, it is.
You know, and we talk about that and I'm like, dude, a lot of really, really successful people that I know and I talk to, and you know, we talk to, they all kind of have a coach or a therapist that they see.
Yeah. Right?
And it's not a bad thing, but I feel like a lot of people have been taught like that's a bad thing.
Yeah, it's taboo. You know?
Yeah.
And that's true. Yeah. Even growing up, I always viewed it as a bad thing. I'm like, whoa, you go to a therapist? Whoa, you go to a coach? There's something wrong with you.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
That's the way I viewed it before, when in all reality is they're actually there to help you. Because the reality is you can't just go to anybody and talk about your problems, especially your friends, your family, your coworkers, et cetera. They will not be able to understand you or give you their honest opinion about what you are going through. Yeah. But having somebody, third party, completely neutral, okay, you know, they hear you out, but then actually repeat everything back to you. That way you can actually have it digest. I mean, that way you can have everything sink in and go, oh, wait, that does sound kind
of
stupid.
Yeah, that came out of my mouth.
Yeah.
You realize the story.
Yeah, the story you're tell yourself.
Oh, really? It ends up sounding stupid. So you're like, oh, wow. Yeah, I'm going to let this one go, yeah. You know? It's so important, though. I am obsessed with human behavior and psychology, and I do study a lot about it and just the mindset, and I very much protect my mindset. I'm like obsessed with protecting it. And I feel like everything starts with the mind, right? Everything starts up here. You envision something.
You project it.
Mm-hmm. So if everything starts up here, why would that not be your priority of making sure that that's the most healthy thing you got? Because your health is the most important thing in life, period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And your mental health is the most important thing. So we all experience trauma. We all go through things in life that are hard. And if you're not willing to do the work, and again, it's not for the sissies, but if you're not willing to face yourself.
Yeah, your inner demons.
You'll carry them. You'll continue to carry them on through life. You can never get rid of it. You just prolong it. So I've done a ton of work with therapists. I've had a coach for the past 10 years, different coaches.
Yeah.
And then I call these blind spots. When something maybe triggers, you're like, whoa, where did that come from? Why is this triggering me?
Yeah.
Just understanding what your emotions are telling you and like, oh, there's something there I need to release. So freeing what isn't free within you is the most important work you can do. And it really does impact everything in your life. It will impact your business. If there's a block there, guess what? There's also a block there for your business.
Say that again. Freeing.
Freeing what isn't free.
Within you. Can we get an applause for that one right there? Are you sleeping over there, Daniel?
Wake up.
You wake your ass up. That's good. I like that. Say it again. Hold on. Say it again. I got to get that in my head.
Sure. So freeing what isn't free within you.
Okay. Freeing what isn't free within you. That is so good because people carry around so much fucking baggage, mental baggage that was passed on. Emotional baggage. Yeah. That was passed on from either parents or school or kids or whatever it was, family. And it always goes back to when you're really, really young and you're so older. When you're older, you don't realize until you see a coach or you see. And when I was doing the work, and I did it for 7 years, every Monday, I was extremely religious and very strict with it. Right. Because I knew I needed somebody to tell me what I didn't want to hear. And when I would listen to the stories I was telling myself that were stressful and that were limiting, right, she would repeat them back to me. And I was like, what? I was like, how crazy does that sound? And I'm literally carrying this with me. And if I didn't ask myself the question, you know, hey, what's holding you back? Hey, or question my beliefs. If I didn't question my beliefs, I wouldn't know that they were there and they were like affecting me subconsciously. Yes. They were affecting my decisions, my behaviors, my actions in life, the way I look at people, the way I treat people. And if I didn't question those, I would be carrying those around. And I go back to what I said, how many people are dealing with this shit and they don't realize it and they take it to their fucking grave? It's so unfortunate. You know what I mean? It's so unfortunate. And I go back to that girl in the parking lot in the back of the school and I'm just like, dude, like, damn, your mom, I would do some work on that. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I didn't tell her that because I didn't want to argue with her. Like, this girl was so passionate about her belief, but I was just like, fuck, that's so sad. You know, that is so sad. And I'm so happy for capitalism and entrepreneurship, you know, like I'm so happy for that because it's a spiritual journey. It really is. You know, having your own business is a spiritual game. Like you literally are playing this game every day where you're questioning your beliefs. You know what I mean? Like, hey, what am I believing about this person?
When you get presented with opportunities of helping people truly, you know, and not only with the product that you're selling or the service you're providing, but also in a sense of like all of your team that works with you, they have all their own things that are happening and their own problems. Yep. And you're the one that they're, you know, you're the sounding board, you're the advisor, the both of you. And so when you're being presented with these issues and your human heart helps them in some way, like that is also a part of the spiritual game. Because at the end of the day, like, business is one part of life and I love it clearly. And so do you guys. And it's so fun. But at the end of the day, when we're in our deathbeds and you look back and think of the impact that you made in people's lives and how you were able to help them grow and transform. And when you lended a hand, when that person thought there was no way out, that is the real game to me.
Yeah. Yeah. That is the real satisfaction, you know, that you get. And that's why Alan and I are both team leaders and we decided to start a team and we didn't wait forever, you know. And I heard this and I disagreed with it, you know, and I'm so happy I have Alan as a business partner because he has so much experience in real estate. But when I heard this, you know, they're like, you need to put in years and years and years and years and years and years before you even think about starting a team, which is fine. I understand that but we had Alan with all the years experience. So I'm like, hey, I don't have to wait that long. I can take him and he could take my experience. Yeah. We could build something great together. But, you know, when I think about that's a story, that's a limitation, you know what I mean, that they're trying to put on you to not either proceed to the next level because somebody's idea of experience is different than someone else's. And you might have somebody who's an amazing leader, you know, who would be such an amazing team leader or an amazing entrepreneur or business owner who could help develop people and coach people and help them in their lives, and they're holding themselves back because their coach or their leader told them,
well, because you're not ready. Because of other people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Their opinion story. Is their opinion. Yeah. Their story is their own story. And the reality is, you know, people, they don't know, you don't know what you don't know. And it's one of those things like, hey, like, do your own thing. Like, follow your heart, follow your gut. That's the one thing I've learned over the years, by the way, is before I would never listen to my intuition or my gut. I always just thought it was kind of like, nah, that's not real or anything. The more I feel like I began actually listening and to it and going with my gut, if it doesn't feel right, you go with your intuition, everything always works out.
100%.
Always.
Yeah, Alan talks about that a lot, and I love that because we always talk about that together. And it's like one of the things we always say is go with your gut. What does your gut tell you? Like, really, what does your gut tell you? Go with your gut. You know, and it always pans out. But I know that you're running short on time. And I'm actually pretty happy we didn't get into title because title's fucking boring. You're right. Title's short at this point.
These are way better conversations.
But this is an entrepreneur podcast. And I really want people to understand and see, like, hey, you know, you're an immigrant. You came here from an immigrant country. And you were 11 years old when you got here. And you speak really good English. Like, I'm so, you know, I there's a small accent there, but it's a very beautiful accent, you know. And I think it complements you very well. But look at your story, you know, look at all the struggles and the challenges you've gone through. And I mean, it's safe to say that you are very successful in life and that, you know, I'm happy that Alan introduced all of us, you know, But I'm extremely happy and proud of you, right? And excited to see where you guys go.
Thank you.
And I'm really happy you came on the podcast and shared some of your ideas and, you know, some of your insight on life and how you view the world. So thank you for being here.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Do you have any words you want to give out? Shout out to the company. Maybe drop some Instagram handle.
Yeah. If you guys want to hear more of my mindset and just good advice in life, you can follow me on Instagram. It's Nuria, spelled N-U-R-I-A dot P, as in Paula, dot Rivera, R-I-V-E-R-A.
Yeah, but so, that's serious what you just said, because you do coaching, right?
And yeah, I wish I had more time for it, actually, because I really do love this. Like, this conversation we just had today was, like, top-notch for me. This is the stuff I actually want to talk about and go deep within, because I feel like that's the reality and that's the authenticity of life.
Yeah.
And so, yes, if there's any, if you'd like to learn more about the programs I have and group coaching that I provide, please go on my handle and reach out to me. I'm pretty good about reading all of my messages. And so, yeah, just go and message me there. And before we end, I definitely just want to thank you guys. And it's truly an honor to be here. And I feel like we're super in alignment with so many things. And I'm also very proud of what you're doing. So
thank you. No, yeah. It's absolute pleasure to have you here. I'm glad that you were our very first guest here at the new studio.
Yeah.
And I'm like, who better than Nuria?
Oh, yeah.
We were talking about it, going, who are we going to get? And like, no, we had a few other people in mind, but we're like, who is the one that we truly feel like we can actually have a serious, authentic conversation with? You know, you have a lot of other podcasts and shows where it's scripted. They already know what they're going to already talk about. People are telling you, hey, say this, say that. Right?
Yeah.
People are telling you, like, hey, say this. And you're like, oh, okay, hey. But, like, it's just real. It's raw. Like, whatever comes out, comes out.
We've seen a couple. Oh, my gosh. I just died.
I don't think I could even do it. Like, if someone told me to say something a certain way, I'd be like, I can't.
No, you can't. That's not authentic.
That's a follower right there. And, you know, we are all leaders. And I feel like there needs to be more leaders out there. Too many people just follow the crowd. Follow what other people tell them. Follow what their parents tell them. Follow what whoever it might be tells them. Like, dude,
live
your own life.
Be a rebel. Be a rebel in your life.
Yep.
There we go.
You gotta stand out from the crowd. Like, you have to. You gotta be different. That's why I love what you're doing. I love what we're doing. Is we are disrupting the industry because we see a flaw in it and we see that it can be done better. And that's why we are doing everything we're doing. That's why, I'm like looking forward to this journey. I'm glad that we're documenting everything. We got like what, 4 cameras in here. And we're documenting the whole thing. And now that we have our own building, now that we have our own space, we have unlimited creativity and unlimited potential. Mm-hmm. And this is just the beginning. I feel like, man, like, we are literally just getting warmed up. You are as well. It's going to be a fun year.
Just the beginning.
Yeah. The coaching thing I really love, and I want to get you guys in here because you did a class for us a while ago. Mm-hmm. And you had Kathy Moore. Kathy, come by. And
I love Kathy, by the way.
I love Kathy.
Dude, Kathy's awesome. Her energy.
Yeah, but she's doing coaching also, right? To help agents and to help people out there. So
she's a development coach.
Yeah. So if you're an agent out there and you guys are looking for some support, you know, Novation Title has a program set up, right?
Yeah, where I'm all about education. Yeah. So I really want to bring actual value to people. And so if we can really actually help you grow your business, then that's awesome. And I couldn't have found anyone better than Kathy Moore. She comes from your shoes.
Yeah.
So for many years, and she's helped many agents succeed. And so that was important to me. And she was like perfect for that role.
So any agents out there looking for some support,
holler
at Nuria. So it's Nuria dot
P
dot Rivera. Okay. Yes. We'll put that in the description below. Alan, thank you so much for being here. So happy we got this done, bro.
Me too.
It's been a long time coming.
It's been a pain getting office, the studio, I'm remodeling my house. Yeah. So much going on.
But we always execute.
Made it happen.
We always execute. We always do what we say we're going to do. And that's the one thing I hold extremely true to my heart. You guys know that. If you're saying to do something, you fucking do it. right?
I love it.
Yeah. Okay. So awesome. Daniel, thank you for being here today. This is the second podcast I think you watched live, which is pretty cool. We're going to get a camera on you. We'll put it somewhere in the corner. You can set that up, I'm sure. But awesome. Thank you for being here, guys, and joining us. And for all you guys who waited patiently, thank you. And we'll see you guys on the next one.